Ladies and gentlemen, hamujambo. Hamujambo tena. I think everybody should know one basic Swahili word. Jambo and muzuri sana. Deborah, do you already know that?
Absolutely.
Great. First of all, allow me to take this opportunity to welcome you most warmly on our session this afternoon. We are behind schedule a little bit, but we'll try and catch up. It's a session on private-public partnership and how we can integrate SMEs into the major global economy. And I'll want to take this opportunity to introduce our presenters and panelists. On my far left is George Omuga, who works with Ngorongo Tea Factory. He's a general manager. George?
Hamjambo.
Thank you. Next to him is Mr. Patrick Gauka, a senior program manager with the CBI, a development agency of the Netherlands government arm. Patrick?
Good afternoon.
Thank you. Next to him is Christoph, one of the hosts from the TDS. Chris? Oh, that's why you are here. Okay. Great. And next to Christoph, we have a special lady amongst the gentlemen, Caro Karaoke, who is the CEO of Kepsa. Karibu, Caro. And then we've got next Samuel Ogola from the T Directorate, which is one of the pillars of AFA under the Ministry of Agriculture, Livestock and Fisheries of Kenya. Samuel? And finally, myself. I'm Phoebe Owor. I manage a project for the CBI, the Tea Value Addition Project in Kenya. Thank you. We've got both presentations and a panel discussion. And the process will have three presentations. Are you hearing me? We've got three presentations. The first one on the floor will be Christoph from TDS, and then the CBI team will have a presentation. Within the presentation, we have four presenters, and that is Patrick, myself, and Samuel Ogola, and eventually George Omuga. And then finally, the ladies are always first, but now men before. Carol will clear the presentation. After the presentations, we'll have the floor opened for Q&A, for any issues emerging, or concerns, or additions, or questions. And without any wasting of time, I would like to start off with Christoph, who is not having a presentation. He's a bit of a techno freak, so he'll take it verbally. Christoph.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Phoebe. What I'll try to do this morning is maybe make a more of a kind of general presentation related to policy issues that arise in the context of integrating SMEs in the global economy and particularly in global value chains. And I think the next speakers will probably go much more into the details and the practicalities and the nitty-gritty of these issues with specific examples. But to start with, I think it's important to stress the importance of SMEs. Generally, we know that globally they represent 95% of all total enterprises in the world, 60 to 70% of employment, and particularly in the context of developing countries, they play a very important role in diversification and value addition and generally in the development of the economies. Now, to really unleash their potential, one of the main challenges, of course, consists in increasing their productivity, their competitiveness, making sure they get higher wages or at least similar to the one applied in larger enterprises. Now, the emergence of global value chains may offer a potential to address some of these limitations. by integrating SMEs in the kind of international division of labor. And these new opportunities largely come from the international fragmentation of production networks. You know, in the past, you were exporting a car, you would produce the car wholly in your country, and only certain enterprises or firms were able to do that. Nowadays, production networks are really spread all over the world, and increasingly, bits and parts, components, can be produced in different places. And that obviously creates a lot of opportunities for specialization and, of course, the integration of small and medium economies. And some of the empirical evidence that we have in this area tend to show that when SMEs manage to integrate in those value chains, they get better jobs, they get better wages, it helps with diversification, it helps with technology, with innovation, with knowledge transfer, with quality of products, and so on and so forth. That is not to say that this is automatic, that is not to say that this is easy. We know that global value chains are largely led by leading firms. They're the ones who make the investment decisions. These investment decisions might or might not generate opportunities for upgrading and for integration. Some are very footloose type of investment. There's also a risk of higher volatility. But by and large, there is, at least in theory, an increased potential. Now, what countries have usually done, at least those who were interested in integrating those value chains, they've basically taken two different kinds of approach. A first kind of traditional approach is basically to say, well, we need to create some kind of an enabling environment through very horizontal policies. We need to improve our infrastructure, soft infrastructure, hard infrastructure, improve our connectivity, have a predictable and stable macroeconomic environment, an open trading system, investments, education, and so on and so forth. There is another approach which has been probably to have more kind of sector-specific or vertical type of policies, sometimes including industrial policies, where the government really targets specific sectors and use different kinds of instruments, which could be government procurement, which could be infant industry protection, which could be export processing zones, to try to promote specific sectors. Now, this second type of approach tends to be a bit more controversial because some argue that the risk of government failures is very high. You might run encounter to some of your international obligations. But what we're seeing in this area is probably a kind of new trend, new types of sectoral approaches, which try to involve as much as possible the private sector, identify really what are the competitive advantages, the binding constraints, the bottlenecks, do a whole kind of value chain analysis, and try to overcome some of these things. We have been working a little bit on the case in Cambodia that comes to mind, where they undertook that exercise in the rice sector, and they came up with this rice strategy. They started basically from the realization that at the farm gates, Cambodian rice producers could produce rice at a price that was cheaper than Thailand. But by the time the rice got to the port and was exported, the price was much higher. So what they did is they really looked at the whole value chain and the whole process, trying to understand where the costs were increasing and which stages between, you know, the farm gate, the production, the transport, the port facilities, and try to address some of these constraints one by one, and it has shown some success. Now, what I'd like to argue is that these kind of policies might be all good and nice, but in most cases they fail to really address the fundamental concerns and problems that SMEs are facing. And I think one has to really understand what are the specificities and the particular challenges that SMEs are facing and start designing specific programs, specific institutions to address those. And I think there are three main kind of challenges and specific problems that one can broadly, you know, define for SMEs. And I can go through them very quickly and maybe give a few examples of what kind of responses can be brought by governments in cooperation with the private sector to try to address them. There was, by the way, yesterday a very interesting meeting organized by ITC and IDB, where Minister of Trade from Rwanda, Mr. Kanimba, came and talked a little bit about the experience of Rwanda in that in that field and some of the initiatives they have taken. And I really encourage you to look at their experience because I think it's quite interesting in that respect. So the first problem that SMEs are facing is access to credit and access to capital. We know that it's very difficult for SMEs to comply with the requirements that the bank and the financial sector or the commercial financial sector is imposing. It's very difficult for them to deal with the very high interest rates. And you end up in a situation where you kind of get a market failure, where you end up with really kind of a suboptimal financing that goes to SMEs. And I think to address this particular problem, you need very specific and targeted approaches. One of the examples that was, for example, done in the case of Rwanda is first they have designed institutions that would just receive SMEs, help assess the potential of their projects, of their ideas, of their initiatives, help assess the risks, and then try to direct them and connect them with the right kind of financial institution that could address their particular issue. They also have come up with a business development funds where you can go maybe sometimes a little bit further where the financial market really will not be able to lend you money provide help with fundraising, help with venture capital or direct investment really from the government. So I think there is a set of institutions that one can try to set up really to address this particular problem. The second problem that many SMEs are facing is once they're established, it's about scaling up. It's about continue to expand. It's about maybe adding value to their products, define a development strategy. And this is also an area that often requires specific support. One issue, for example, is access to technology and innovation. Very difficult for SMEs to really have appropriate technologies, appropriate innovation that really fits their specific concerns. And here again, this idea of public-private partnership where some institution can try to connect the SMEs with the innovation that is happening with universities, with innovation systems, can be exceedingly helpful. Establishing platforms for dialogues where you can bring together SMEs, but also government, NGOs, donors, look at their strategies, and see what are the development opportunities, organizing them in clusters, and so on. So there's a whole set of initiatives that could be taken in that area. And finally, the last big problem that many SMEs are facing is when they try to move from the domestic market and try to get access to international market. And there we immediately come up with information failures. And SMEs, if you look at some of the surveys that have been done, face this as much more of a problem than larger enterprises. They need market information about the potential markets, about trends, about the requirements, and they need help in connecting with buyers. Once this happens, they need help in complying with standards, public standards, private standards, certification, recognition, and so on and so forth. And finally, when they start having connections with potential buyers, trade financing becomes a major issue. Making sure that you have the cash flow, that you have the funds to respond to specific demands. And that's also an area where a government intervention might be needed in terms of export guarantees, in terms of matching grants, in terms of providing subsidized interest rates. So these are all kind of areas and examples where I think particularly public-private partnership types of approach can be particularly helpful. And these public-private partnerships, they can involve a wide range of actors. It could be with governments. It could be with donors or outside agency. Well, CBI is doing fantastic work. There are other initiatives in Africa by USAID and others. But it can also be international or intergovernmental organizations. ITC has been doing a great job in this area. The Inter-American Development Bank also establishing platforms to connect financial institutions, potential buyers, SMEs, and so on and so forth. So in my view, this is really in this type of area that one should look at. Now, if I have one or two more minutes, 1 minute, okay, let me say just a few words. I think that there's also a third level which one should keep in mind, which is also the international level, and look at how international policy frameworks can also facilitate integration of SMEs in the global economy. And I'll just mention three areas which I think are important. One is trade facilitation. We have a trade facilitation agreement in the WTO, which is limited in scope, but it's a good start, and it's probably something that can help, particularly in reducing the cost of business. We have systems and rules that should deal with international standards, trying to facilitate the use of international standards, facilitate mutual recognition, make it easier for SMEs that want to export to different markets to make sure that they can comply with all these different requirements. And a last issue, which I think is probably something for the future, but which it would be very important for SMEs, is this issue of digital trade. We know that SMEs are much more than any other types of firms using e-commerce, digital trade, and setting the broad international framework in that area to facilitate this would clearly benefit SMEs. So let me stop here. Sorry if I was a bit too long. Now more to the concrete and specific issues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christoph. He's given us four areas. He's touched on access to credit and finance as a challenge to the SMEs. He was giving a global perspective. He's also touched on value addition, which is mainly contributed to lack of technology, and innovation and establishment of platforms and dialogue platforms. And most importantly, he's also touched on lack of relevant information to support the exporters from developing countries to the north. And finally, he's touched on the international trade policy, which I think is a big hindrance. We go next to CBI, which is getting more specific. CBI, I think, will get a bit more specific. Christoph gave us an overview. And Patrick, please.
Yes, thank you, Thiebe. Good afternoon, everybody. Let me take you through the example of CBI programs and projects in which we include the public-private dialogue since a couple of years. I'm myself responsible for programs in East and Southern Africa, specifically in the agricultural sector, and we will give you an example on the tea sector in Kenya, where we work on value addition by including the public and the private sector. Let me see if this works. Yeah. That's my first slide. There we go. So I'll very briefly go into some background information on the CBI. I won't spoil you that much with CBI as such, but I think it's good to give you some understanding of how we work and who we are. I think it's quite practical to show you a brief video and explain you then about the concept of export market readiness and the inclusion of public-private dialogue in our programs. Before we go to the example of tea in Kenya and the role of the BSOs in it and the private sector. Now, the CBI, rather than it stands for the Central Bureau of Intelligence, we are the Central Center for the Promotion of Imports from Developing Countries, and the letter B is the Dutch word for promotion. We are funded by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in the Netherlands, and our mandate is actually to create an increase in sustainable exports from developing countries to the foreign markets. The fact that we were founded more than 40 years ago, I can think that it tells something about the rate of success of CBI programs. We consider ourselves as the expert in export development and export promotion, specifically to the European market. We have successfully exported as many exporters from developing countries to the EU the last more than 40 years in the meantime. That creates an export increase, of course, that is our mandate, our focus area. But we also developed services and products for the supporting layer in the value chain, being the sector associations and the chambers of commerce. We call them business support organizations or trade support institutions. And last but not least, we are quite known on about our market information on EU markets. If you go to our webpage, cbi.eu/marketintel, you will find many studies available, brief studies actually, quite accessible, on market access requirements, trade channels, potential export markets, buyer requirements, etc., on specific products or sectors. There we go. Well, we cannot support SME exporters without including, of course, the importers, on the other hand. So what we do is, in the beginning, at the baseline situation, we go into depth in each individual exporter and look for their needs and what we need to work on in order to develop their capacity to make them export market ready. But of course, we need to know if there's a market as well. So that's why we need importers, and we need to know what their experiences are, for example, with importing a specific product from a specific country. As I told you, we also include the BSOs, the business supporting organizations, because we found out that we can support many individual exporters, but it creates more synergy by including the business support organizations and in this way lift up a part of the value chain or the whole value chain. And in many cases we also include the policy makers, for example, when it comes to setting up a sector export marketing strategy. So we have four target groups in our what we call integrated programs, and this is actually our framework for public-private dialogue. Now we do that, I'm mainly myself working in the agricultural sector, but we also work in the industrial sector and the consumer sector and the services sector. So we look on the one hand on the markets, at the market demands in export markets, and on the other hand on the supply potential of specific countries. Let me go show you. Oh, now I'm going too fast. I was warned for that. I'll go back. Let me give you an example by showing you a brief video on the value addition projects that we do. It's actually mentioned for the target group importers, to show the importers what is going on in specific sectors. You will see an example of value addition in the Kenya tea sector, and where George is acting actually. You will see an example on oil seeds from Ethiopia, and you will see an example of coffee, specialty coffee from Uganda.
We all know that life is about the simple pleasures, waking up to the aroma of brewing coffee. And more, we want nothing but the very best. for consumers to enjoy tasty and healthy products that are grown with respect for people and for our planet, buyers need consistent, high quality and reliable supply chains. In Eastern and Southern Africa, more and more suppliers meet these demands. CBI supports these suppliers to unleash their potential for export of natural ingredients to regional and European markets.
Kenya is the largest exporter of black tea in the world. Kenyan tea is produced in a near organic way because in areas where tea production is done in Kenya, we don't use herbicides in tea, we don't use pesticides in tea. The major problem of selling tea in Kenya is because Kenya sells its tea in bulk. 95% of Kenyan black tea production is sold in bulk through the auction. The prices in the auction can drop to a level that is uneconomical to the producers. When CBI came into the scene, they came to build up capacity in terms of value addition to make us be informed on the returns we could get from adding value to our Kenyan tea instead of selling the tea through bulk. They managed to undertake us through a number of trainings in terms of market intelligence, in terms of product development, and in terms of networking.
Coffee is one of the most important cash crops in Uganda, Africa's second largest coffee producer and the number one Robusta producer. Many exporters produce the quality that buyers in Europe ask for.
So we sell our coffee to African markets. We also do exports to the Middle East. We are the only company in the CBI program that does its own roasting. Due to the cooperation with CBI and the expert guidance by the CBI coffee expert, we are now receiving very interesting proposals from roasters in the European Union.
Ethiopian sesame seed is seen by many as the finest available. Yet dropping reliability made trade links with Europe suffer. Today, Ethiopia, the world's largest exporter of sesame, exports mostly to China on the basis of ad hoc relationships and high price competition. Ethiopia is making great strides to improve the sector.
In our sesame processing plant, we produce sesame of a quality that perfectly meets European demands. We are PRC certified. If you ask me, it is time to re-establish relations by understanding and meeting European buyers' needs with the assistance of CBI.
When we were trained by CBI on product diversification, we came to realize that we'll get more through processing, packaging, and selling of specialty teas. That's the reason why we decided to plant purple tea. Our first harvest of purple tea will be done in 3 months' time from today. Now, after we are through with the purple tea, we'll start doing flavored teas, we'll start trials to do chamomile teas, to do ginger teas.
The special brand that we're preparing for the European market with CBI is called Bugisu Gold. It's a premium single origin specialty roasted coffee. The beans come from the famous Mount Elgon region, where we work with organic farmers and with local women in an inclusive business model. It's a better business decision for importers to buy value-added coffee than bulk coffee because the EU consumers are interested in traceable coffee that is of the highest quality because they are very much interested to know what is happening at the source of the coffee. And Star Cafe offers that. We are able to offer the traceability of the coffee from the farm to the cup.
Buyers and consumers can check all this through certifications. Star Cafe holds the ISO 9001:2008 certification for quality management and is close to getting the Organic and 4C Association certifications. Ambercell Trading in Ethiopia already holds 5 certifications.
Ambercell is the best company for European importers because it establishes traceable systems from the production side up to processing and then up to destination markets. Ambassel has its own cleaning machine, its own hulling machine, its own tahina and roasting processing machine. And it has also its own well-established warehouses with machines as well. So in addition to this, Ambassel is also producer of organic sesame seeds. It has its own farm as well. I think more and more people, buyers and exporters alike, are realizing what huge benefits export to Europe can bring to everybody.
Good. I think the video shows you that when we're talking about value addition and bringing companies, small, medium-sized exporters, to the international export market, they need three things. The concept is quite simple, but the answer, it takes a longer time, actually. One is that you need a market proposition, which is the result of thorough study. You need to know where is my market segment, what are the market requirements, what are the buyer requirements, etc. So it ends up with a short market proposition. Why should the buyer buy your product and not your neighbor's ones or your neighboring country ones? You need to have a product that is ready for the market, and you need to have the internal processes in order to be able to deliver the product. So CBI is mainly focusing on the first one, but also we support on the other two ones. But that's in a nutshell, actually, the concept to bring companies to the export market. Well, the answer, of course, the work is much broader, bigger than these simple three elements. But this is what it's all about. Just to keep it brief, now the role of public-private dialogue in our programs, is, since we work in an integrated way, that means that we do not only include the individual exporters, but also the business supporting organizations and the policy makers, we think it's it creates a bigger effect than focusing on solely the individual exporters. We see that SMEs communicate the constraints they encounter to export to the policymakers and also to the BSOs. So we think that discussion is already an added value. What we also noticed, for example, as well in the tea sector in Kenya, is that the government explains the supporting policy for the sector. The government in Ethiopia was Kenya was, for example, working on the national tea policy. And in this way, the government gets feedback from the private sector as well, if something is not going to work or not, and what are the real issues they encounter as individual companies. In the end, the result is bigger than the individual company achievements. Well, these are just a few examples of subjects that we, or issues that are raised when we when we talk about public-private dialogue. I won't go into very much detail now, looking at the time as well. Let me just pick a few of this list. We noticed that there's, for example, a lot of discussion on import taxation when it comes to importing process machinery. For example, noticed that lots of small exporters, they have no information and don't know where to find information on legal and buyer requirements and what to do with it, how to deal with it. So I think public-private dialogue, collaboration, let me call it a collaboration, creates more effect than just struggling on your own. I think it's good to move to the example of the tea project that we have specifically in Kenya on value addition, where we include both public and private sector. So let me give the words to Phoebe.
When your boss is talking, you only keep a note. Even if he's taking more time, you don't open my mouth. Eh? Thank you very much, Patrick. I think I'll get a bit more specific and look at a project we are handling in Kenya, and that is adding value to Kenyan tea so that Kenyan tea can be exported with value addition. At the end of it, add to the shilling in the pocket of the farmer. Hmm. Caroline. Ah, great, got it. That is the structure of how CBI works. At the top, of course, we have the bilateral agreement between the two governments. And then CBI comes down to collaborate and get into partnership with the line ministry, depending on the sector. In this regard, it is the Ministry of Agriculture, Livestock and Fisheries in Kenya, and more specifically to the AFA, which holds or houses the Tea Directorate of Kenya. Then after that, at the lower level, of course, we work with the companies or the enterprises. Then we work with the regulatory body. Here, it is the Tea Directorate under the umbrella of AFA. At the top, the Ministry of Agriculture. And then we have the business support organizations, the likes of Exports Promotion Council of Kenya, the East African Tea Traders Association in Mombasa. And then we also have business management organizations. And those are organizations that are member-based and privately run. And finally, we also collaborate and work in partnership with other development organizations, both local NGOs and international NGOs, where we find that we could have relevance and support mechanisms and have some synergies together. At the bottom level, ordinarily, all those people at the top are picked from the stakeholder platform. And the stakeholder, of course, encompasses everybody and all the organizations that are within that particular sector. The process of how CBI proceeds, and this is in relevance to the tea project we have in Kenya. First, we map the stakeholders, most importantly, and also look at the sector analysis. What are some of the challenges within the sector, some of the constraints, and what could CBI be able to lift? What could the government contribute, and what would the private sector contribute? That's why we look at it as a PPP approach, where all the three key components are housed together and work in collaboration. The diagnosis is an important aspect. We look at what are the challenges, particularly of the BSOs, what are the capacity gaps in terms of knowledge and information, and we also look at the capacity gaps within the enterprises to support us draw up interventions. But most importantly are the two last bullets. One is on SMEs and BSOs to attend trade fairs after the preparation on how to trade, exchange of knowledge, capacity building them on export trade. Eventually, the market entry is a key component. And CBI takes a deliberate initiative of taking the exporters to the markets of relevance after they have segmented their markets and gives them the opportunity to meet the buyers, dialogue with the buyers, and initiate business. In the tea sector specifically, we've got about, we are at the end of the project. We have about 6 trade fairs we are going to attend. We just did one in Nigeria, which was quite successful this year in November. We've got one in Cairo. We're going to have one in Germany, and we'll have one in Kenya. The last bullet to me is the most important because CBI looks at sustainability of its projects, and that's where we build the capacity of the BSOs who will be able to upscale and cascade this knowledge transfer and information beyond the project. We know that the projects have shelf lives. Ordinarily, it is 3 years to 5 years. And after that, what? So we start by building the sustainability component by involving both the government, the private sector, and the business community, and the business support organizations to transfer knowledge to them. What are some of the achievements we get as a result of that approach? Ownership by stakeholders is key. For any project to succeed and run well, there must be ownership from the stakeholders. Transparency of interventions. We sit around table and look at the challenges within the sector and agree what are most critical, what are the low-hanging fruits that we can address, and who does what. Because there are some instances where CBI cannot be able, like infrastructure. And there are some instances where CBI is quite good, like transfer of knowledge and information about exports. And there are some instances where the BSOs come in, transfer of knowledge and information to the private sector. You find that there's a lot of appreciation Ordinarily, there's always very cold blood, with due respect to the government machinery in the room. There's always cold blood between the private sector and the government arms. They look at the government as a punitive arm. Yet when you create the private sector and public sector dialogue platform, there's a lot of understanding, there's a lot of appreciation, there's a lot of dialogue which goes on, and everybody understands their role, everybody knows what they should do, and everybody acknowledges what is the challenge of the other party. We, as CBI, use the PPP approach, and we've been able to utilize a lot of machinery from the government. And an example in place is where we have no presence, like in Nigeria, CBI didn't have presence. So we use the government of Kenya, the Ministry of Agriculture, through the T Directorate, to use the Embassy of Kenya in Nigeria to uptake and prepare for us and organize the trade fair, which I think worked very well. And that is because of the dialogue that we've created and the platform that we created, that we work with the government and the private sector together. Finally, this arrangement creates and instills sustainability for further upscaling. And I think that is the most important part of the PPP, bringing in the private sector, bringing in the public, and including the business support organizations and the business management organizations. The bottom line is leaving the sustainability, because beyond the project, what next? Who takes up this information? Who upscales it? Who transfers further? It is the business support organizations. Thank you very much. I'll leave the next part to Sami Ogola, who is part of the arm, the regulatory arm. We call them in Kenya Baba na Mama.
Good afternoon. I'm government in the respect for tea, so normally you expect government to be serious and forlorn, isn't it? In tea, it's not the case. We work very closely with the industry. That's why the tea industry is doing very well. However, in regulatory matters, you have to put the foot down. So issues of ensuring quality standards, safety of the product, hygiene, and all these, we have the rules. If you want to come and register to manufacture, grow, or export tea, there are rules. And our work primarily has been to make sure that there's law and order. However, for SMEs, it's a special case, because they come and tell them, okay, this is the form, these are the terms and conditions, and most of them don't come back. Others come back and they are not able to meet the requirements, and it has been a challenge. However, when CBI joined, we were able to realize that there's a gap. You're just showing the applicant or the SME the law does not help them. You have to reach out. There's the organizations, that the business support organizations in the industry, the business associations, and the government, we had to work together. And most times, of course, the perspectives are different, but as we sat down through capacity building, we realized we can work together, actually. Some of the procedures have been simplified, and the synergy created, we've been able then to bring in the SMEs and work with them quite well. We do want to thank CBI for that. I think going forward, the SMEs who want to come and join in the tea industry, as you know, we are exporting all a big chunk of our tea in bulk. There's a big opportunity there for SMEs to brand, blend, and package and export. And with the program that you have been taken through, we think now the business support framework within the Tea Directorate is much more friendly to the SMEs. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's the first time I'm hearing a clap, eh? Thank you. Thank you very much, Sam. I think we want to get to the enterprise. And for that, I'll call George Omuga, who is an entrepreneur and working. Okay.
Thank you. I believe you heard that Kenyan tea is produced in a near organic way. So I want to encourage you to take more of Kenyan tea. As an entrepreneur in the tea industry and as a beneficiary of the CBI program, I would like to report the advantages of the PPP program, because as an individual company, we could not go it alone. Now, when we joined the program, we realized that there were a number of advantages we could realize from the private and public partnership. Now, the first advantage is that from the government side, we are getting the regulatory services from the government side, that is from the tea directorate. And it is important to note that doing business is very challenging. So we needed information, and we needed markets. That is where the government came in to do what you call trade regulation in terms of the export market. Let me mention that Kenya currently exports about 95% of its tea in bulk, and it's only 5% that is consumed locally and exported in value-added form. Now, there are a number of challenges, especially when it comes to trade barriers, where the government came on board to design trade regulations that are able to meet the international standards and to help us remove the trade barriers that could bar us from exporting our value-added tea to various countries. Then in terms of standard development, you see, for you to compete effectively in the global market, the product must be able to meet certain quality standards. So we've worked together with the government to ensure that our product complies with the international standards. Quite a number of us are ISO certified, that is food safety management system. We are also having another certification called Rainforest Alliance certification that deals with sustainable agriculture in our operations. And these advantages, we've got them from the government. Then in terms of policy development, the trade policy development has been done not by ourselves, but through the government arm, and that has reduced our pain in terms of the struggles we needed to go through to make sure that our products were accepted internationally. Then we were interlinked with various BSOs, and these are the advantages we got from the various BSOs. The first one is market intelligence information. For you to be a good manager and make inroads in business, you need information to make decisions. And this was easily available to us through the various BSOs that we worked with. Then market linkages. You see, we have traditionally relied on three key markets, and that was basically for bulk tea. But in terms of export, in terms of value-added products, we needed to get specific market requirements and specific market trends and specific market demands. And we managed to get this through working together with these various BSOs to get these markets. Then product development and promotion. When we came into the program, we realized that various markets required various types and varieties of teas. And this is where now we opened our eyes to stop over relying on black CTC alone. So we decided to venture into specialty teas. And you heard from the presentation, we have started processing purple tea, which is very rich in anthocyanins. It is a better antioxidant than the normal polyphenols in tea. And I believe we can capitalize on this and explore the health benefit of this product to gain a mileage in the global market. In terms of logistical support, we have a number of organizations we have been working with. Currently, the tea sector is working with Trademark East Africa at the port of Mombasa. They are doing a lot of infrastructure development in Mombasa to ease the export of teas through the port. Last but not least, easy access to BSOs. At least we were brought together. If I needed Export Promotional Council representatives, we were together with them during the training. And this was now very easy and very good because of networking. If I needed something to be done and needed to make some inquiries, I knew the right people to consult to get the right information. Then, in terms of the advantages we got from CBI, and I want to appreciate and applaud CBI for this. In terms of market intelligence, CBI has a link or a website where us as packers and exporters, we could go and get various market requirements and existing markets from various parts of the world. In terms of market intelligence, we were able to know that apart from the Kenyan traditional markets in terms of bulk, there were other additional markets for specialty teas like green tea, white tea, the purple tea, orthodox tea, and now we are confidently able to export and venture into these new markets. Capacity building. Capacity building in terms of competitiveness in the global market. You see, when we started packing for the local market, we had a slightly lower standard of packaging. So our capacity was built to a level whereby we came to realize that for you to be competitive in the global market, we needed to meet a number of standards in terms of the quality of packaging and in terms of the quality of the product and even the product branding itself. And this has given us a mileage in terms of market penetration. Then they also trained us on market entry strategies. For a new player to go into a different market, we needed to understand what this market required. So our capacity was built to, and we were equipped with knowledge to penetrate, design export plans and design export strategies to penetrate these foreign markets. Lastly, CBI has organized a number of trade promotion and trade fairs. Last year, we were in Netherlands. This year, we had a team in Nigeria, and this has proved to be very, very productive for the value addition sector in Kenya. Otherwise, I want to pass my gratitude to CBI for building up capacity and giving us the opportunity to venture into the export market. Lastly, they made it very easy for us to access the various business support organizations, and we are glad that today we are not incapacitated in terms of where to get information and the relevant information based on various market requirements globally. Thank you very much.
Patrick, Kenyans are very biased. They're only clapping for their fellow Kenyans, I can see. Thank you very much, George. When I joined the CBI about 10, 15 years ago, I was a sleek, slim, beautiful young girl. But they have pumped me with a lot of information that I just blew up. Finally, we are having the most important presenter, and this represents the SMEs in Kenya. And before I bring on board, how many of you know about purple tea in Kenya? Purple tea, put up your hand higher. That's a disaster for you Kenyans. I think you better go to the website of Tea Directorate or Kenya Tea Development Authority and look at purple tea. It has a lot of value. It has a lot of health values. Even when you are 70 like me, you look 35. For sure. Purple tea has a lot of health advantages. I would like to welcome Caro, who is the CEO of KEPSA, which is a BMA, a business management organization, taking care of the interests of SMEs in Kenya, multi-sectoral, of course, and that is one of the most important arms in terms of the private sector. Caro, karibu.
Thank you very much. Just a correction, KEPSA is an umbrella body, so we don't only take care of SMEs, but SMEs is a big part of us. So we do take care of all the private sector in the country, both local and foreign, just to make sure that the ones who are here and are not SMEs and our members don't wonder what if we changed our mandate. No, we haven't changed our mandate. I'll go very quickly. I think a lot has been said by the previous presenters that I wouldn't want to repeat, and so I'll really just introduce what have we been doing, especially on the public-private dialogue side. So let me just, hopefully I can get it. We need to switch it off.
Carol? Pardon?
Point to her.
You have to run like Kenyans to get here. One more? Oh.
Okay, good. Continue. Not yet. Forward. Keep going. Go back.
I go back.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So I'll go very. Okay. Okay, so I'll go very fast. I'll just introduce KEPSA again. It's an umbrella body that was formed in 2003 to just to bring the whole private sector on one umbrella. So it brings 100 associations together and over 200 corporates, and we look at all aspects of the economy. And also what we do to we look at the harmonized agenda of the private sector so that we leave the specific associations like the T people to look at the T specific issues, and we do not get involved unless they need support from us. But the issues that face them like infrastructure, upgrading security and others, then that they can bring to us so that we harmonize with every other sector because that affects everyone. And so how we organize our agenda as KEPSA is under 5 thematic areas, and we call that the national business agenda, which is created every 5 years. And so right now we're implementing the National Business Agenda 2. And that is looking at improving governance and business regulatory environment. And this is where we look at the bills and the policies that affect the private sector, like the Companies Act, the Business Regulatory Bill Act, Insolvency Act that was signed by the President not too long ago, if you may remember. That all falls under that. Governance, you see that we are very involved right now with the whole corruption agenda. That falls under governance. When you talk about peace, and we ran a big campaign before the last election, and we've started running it again, Mkenya Daima. Again, this is all under governance to ensure that we have a political stability, which is important for business. Then upgrading security, and here we look at 2 levels of security. There's security as you know it, which is protection, but there's also security as food security, because as a country, if we are not food secure, we can look at so many other things, but we will not go very far. A country that cannot feed its people, it's not going to develop, and so that's very important for us. Infrastructure development, all that you've been seeing, the highways, the standard gauge rail, the ports, and it was mentioned, like the Mombasa port, the whole port, the port charter, we were very, very involved, and we partnered very closely with TMA and brought everyone else together to ensure that that charter was signed, and we've been monitoring on its implementation. Then enhancing trade and investment, which is very key for us, and this is where our SMEs, a lot of them fall under, and I'll mention what we've been doing on that area with SMEs. And then promoting human capital development and entrepreneurship. Again, if we do not have an educated population, if we do not have a developed human capital, then we cannot compete with the rest of the countries. And we've been proud as a country saying that we have one of the most developed human capital in Africa, and a lot of international organizations. Right now, we have about 25 multinationals based in Nairobi, and a lot of them, if you talk to them, they say it's because apart from everything else that Nairobi offers, is the human capital that draws them here. And then entrepreneurship, and you saw us getting very involved during the GES, the Global Entrepreneurship Summit, and this because our agenda is on entrepreneurship, the startups, and bringing the young people who are in entrepreneurship, but also because this is where a lot, again, the SMEs fall under. The SMEs are in the startups. They're in the growing organizations. And if we do not develop them, you know the life cycle of an SME. The ones, 80% do not go beyond 5 years. And so we've been saying, what do we need to do differently to ensure that we increase the number of the surviving SMEs? So that's what forms our agenda. Okay. I think I'm the one who's... So how do we do this? We form public-private dialogue forums, and these are the platforms we use. We do have a semi-annual presidential roundtable, which I think is the most... that gets most of the PR. So most people think we only meet the president. No, we only meet him twice a year, at most three times a year. And this is only the issues around competitiveness and issues that cannot be resolved in any other forum. But on a monthly basis, bi-monthly basis, we do meet with the minister. And agriculture, I think we've been meeting. We have a very vibrant agriculture sector, looking at all the different aspects of agriculture. And this meets, many of them meet every 2 months, but some of them meet more often, and some of them maybe meet quarterly. And then speakers roundtable, again, this is both the Senate and the National Assembly. And how we develop our platforms, it's how government organizes itself, because we need to engage with the different levels of government. So now with two levels of parliament, we do have both forums. With two levels of national government and the county government, we also do have a governor's summit. And about three weeks ago, we did meet all the county executives, again, because we know they're the policy makers. Before the governors can make the real policies, the people who really oil the machine of the counties is actually the county executives. And so it's important for us to engage with them. Chief Justice is important. If we cannot resolve disputes for within private sector and private sector and government and all the whole issue of commercial justice, then we can, the cost of doing business becomes very expensive. And so we have a relationship also with the judiciary. And then we also have regional forums. I've talked about, I mentioned some of the big infrastructure projects. We do have two levels of our summit, the East African Council Summit, and we also have the Northern Corridor Summit. And this both look at different areas. The East Africa looks at everything East Africa. The Northern Corridor is very focused, especially on the projects around the Northern Corridor, mainly the infrastructure projects, but also security, ICT, and others. Then development partners, as you've heard about CBI, we do have a development partners where Netherlands sits in that forum, and many others, because they are part of development of this country. And so we need to engage with them so that they put their money and their resources and their technical knowledge in the right places that move this country forward. And so we do have engagement with them. Then we do engage with regular agencies, I think the CABs, the KRAs, and others, because they play a big role especially in the regulation of the business environment. And then how do we look at the big picture? I think I'll spend maybe a minute here, because that had been mentioned by CBI. And if you look at different countries and in terms of SMEs, you realize the percentage of enterprises per country. And if you look at the red, you can see India has one of the largest SMEs at 95%. If you look at contribution of GDP, that's a green, you'll see how much each country contributes in terms of GDP. A good example, look at Singapore. And look at 99% of Singapore enterprises are actually SMEs. But look at the contribution, it's almost at least 50%. But Germany has even higher, 99%. Because at times when we talk about SMEs, people think of only mama mboga, and think other countries do not have SMEs. But a lot of actually what we call big industries here are actually SMEs in many of these developed countries. And so when we talk about Germany and we look at the SME and they are 99.9, they're actually a lot of what we would call the big industries here. But that's what captures SMEs. But look at the contribution of their GDP. At the same time, look at the number of workforce. You know, and even in Kenya, almost 80% of our workforce is in the SME sector. So again, it makes it a very, very important sector. So if you look at why it is important to look at this sector, it's because of the number of people it employs, and at the same time, the number of enterprises it contributes to our country. So that, if the higher those two numbers are, we need to make sure that it correlates to growth in GDP, which is what has been missing in our own country, because it's been contributing about maybe 20 to 25% of GDP, which we need to really, really increase because of the numbers it captures. Okay, I guess I'm the last speaker, so it's not working. On terms of our development objectives, so what have we really been doing on SME development? As I said, we represent everyone. We bring together everyone and give platform to everyone, whether you're big or small. So for us, one of the things we've been doing is increasing the number of startups, because you meet a lot of people who say, I'd like to go into business, but I don't even know where to start. So we've been saying, how do we ensure that people can begin? And so we have a lot of those who, the NILABs and others who are in innovation centers who bring people who want to have startups, but also other in other sectors. You find big manufacturers who are saying, we need supplies from the small people. So how do we help them start so that they can supply to our big industries? Then facilitate their growth. Again, I talked about the life cycle of SMEs. Many of them do not go beyond 5 years. And so we've been saying, how do we increase that number so that we facilitate they grow, but the same the survival rate, that they, many of them survive the five-year cycle. Then a clear SMEs startup strategy to foster SMEs and graduate them from small to large. And here is where we are looking at a model where we're going to be saying, and this has been done in other countries, and we group them in groups, the startups, the upcoming ones, the growing ones, and the large ones, and that each of them has to help the other one grow. And so that's a program we're going to be starting in KEPSA very soon, and hopefully that that can really see, so that if we have like a General Electric, who are the people they get supplies from, so how can they develop that level? And then those ones, who are the ones below them, and how can they develop them further from where they are? And so that's a program we'll be hoping to be running from next year. Then facilitate the smooth exit of losers, providing second and more chances. Not every time you begin something that you succeed. You know, we've heard of so many multinationals today who started 5 times, 10 times, but they never gave up because there was a way that they were able to be facilitated. They were still able to access credit again. They were still able to have an environment where they could grow. But many of our SMEs, we find that when they die, they die. And so many of the people end up now going to look for a job. You hear someone saying, oh, I tried business, it didn't work out, so I've gone to employment. So how can we make those help those people go back and start again? And even say, what are the lessons you learned and what can you do differently? So that's something, again, we'll be doing a lot. We are trying to do a lot. Formalizing of them to be an incorporation. You find a lot of our SMEs are in the informal sector. We talk a lot about Jua Kali and sometimes celebrate Jua Kali and not think about what are they missing out by not formalizing. We only think that the only thing they are actually benefiting by not paying taxes, actually they are losing out. Because when you're not formalized, when you're not incorporated, there are a lot of benefits you miss out, you know, in terms of credit, in terms of partnerships, networking, joining other formal organizations, supplying into formal organizations. So there are more benefits in formalizing than losing. And so we're really encouraging a lot of the informal sector, where a majority of our SMEs are, to formalize. Then foster the SME exporters, and it was so good to hear about what's happening in one of the tea companies and in the tea sector, and would like to see a lot of that happening in a lot of more other sectors, because SMEs are in all the sectors of the economy, not only agriculture. And I'm trying to move very fast, sorry. So over the years, we've learned that, and that again was mentioned by CBI, that actually public-private dialogue really works. A structured public-private dialogue, not where every individual, every company, every association goes to government, but where there's a structure. So what we do, we always bring the private sector together and say, are you affected by security or do you affect security? Are you a player in security? Then you form that sector of security. And then we agree, these are the issues we'd like to discuss with government. These are the things we'd like to see ourselves as private sector grow and be involved in. This is what we'd like to contribute to the country. And then we go to government and have that discussion. So we don't go to government with a shopping list. Here is what we'd like you government to do. But we go to them and say, we are partners in development. So would like, if you do 1, 2, 3, this is what will happen. These are the jobs we'll be able to create. This is the wealth that will come to the country. But also, this is our contribution. We can supply, we can help in technology, we can help in training, we can help in supplying this. So we come to government with that. And so that's how our PPD works. And on the SME side, for a long time, for almost 19 years, the SME sector kept trying to get an act of parliament. Because if you don't have a policy that guides you, a regulatory that governs your sector, it's very, very hard to be able to engage government, to be able to access the different things that that sector is offered. And so as KEPSA, we took that again as our mandate and really worked on that bill and took it in actually to parliament as a private member's bill, as a KEPSA bill, so that it could go through and ensure that through the process, we made sure that it safeguarded the interest of the SMEs. Thank you very much. Wow.
I thought you need a better clap than that, really. Yeah, the girl is carrying a whole world on her head. Thank you very much, Carol. A lot of times when you go to SMEs, and you ask him what are the challenges and give you two challenges. Ordinarily, they'll tell you, give me money and give me a market and leave me alone. But I always tell them, among the five resources that an SME or any enterprise needs, I think is information, not even money. Because when you have the relevant and accurate information, you'll be able to get the money. We'll be able to open the floor after the presentations. And I think the moment has come, we have maybe 10, 15 minutes. We'll want to take a round of questions or concerns. My request is please keep your concerns or your questions, keep it simple and short so that you can get feedback also from the panel. And I have the floor opened. Wow. Okay, with those shoots, we'll take a batch of five questions. Please tell us your name very fast and the organization and shoot your concerns. It would only be easy and polite if you can keep your questions to two concerns so that everybody else can have a chance. We'll start, ladies first, but men before. Number one, number two, Deborah, you come third, and fourth, please. Can you take the mics around?
Okay, thank you very much for your good presentation. My name is Mark Ambito. I'm focusing on technology transfer and innovation. My question is specifically geared to Carol Karaoke. I want to ask on actually technology transfer and innovation in terms of like the small scale sector in Kenya is feeling that KEPS has failed because for the sector like this leather subsector and the textile subsector, the private-public partnership about training, technology training in terms of getting the last design, if you compare Kenya and other countries that have done well like India, it's missing. And the same with the textile subsector, that has really let us down that those two economies have actually been flooded with products from outside. What is KEPS planning to do about that? Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next at the back.
Very briefly, I'm Tony from Ghana. What's your definition of SMEs, number one? And then number two, what does the political four-year election cycle, how does it affect policy consistency? You know, does the policy change when governments change? I would like your experience. And finally, I'd like a copy of your SME law. Is that possible?
Thank you, Tony. Where do you direct your question to?
The lady in red.
The girl in red. Okay, I thought so. And then Deborah.
Deborah from ICTSD. Thank you to all the panel, but my question is really also for the lovely lady in red.
Oh.
Carol, you made a most interesting statement to the effect that, and I hope you will allow me to tweet this out, SMEs need to have second chances to capitalize on lessons learned. This is quite fascinating. Do you have any, is it your experience that second time round SMEs succeed much better than first time rounders? And secondly, how can we think of policies that will actually enable and allow SMEs to have second chances and learn in this way? Thank you.
Deborah wants to know about second buff of SMEs. Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jerry Shitsukane. I have just two questions for Carol. Is how do you facilitate growth of SMEs? Because I'm an SME. If I came to you, how would you facilitate my growth? And how would you, because the topic today is towards a global economy. How would you foster a global market for me as an SME? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And finally, the incubator.
Yep. Good afternoon. My name is Mwangala. I run a business incubator. My concern or my question is how do we use public-private partnerships so that information flows to SMEs? because there's a big gap with information. And then two is concerned with taxes. SMEs are heavily taxed. I have experience from the East Africa region. You know, it's quite a big challenge. So how do we tackle this? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next time I moderate, I'll bring the ladies first because I've seen everybody's firing the lady. Carol. Okay, there's a mic.
Okay, I'll try and answer as many as I can. Okay, let me start with the one on the textile and leather. I can't agree more. I think it's two sectors that for some time we allowed to die, for lack of a better word, but I think there's hope. You know, I like how someone said in one of the movies that hope is coming. And I can assure you, because of the new Kenya industrialization plan that was launched not too long ago, the two sectors and the one main big sector that is highlighted is actually leather and textiles. And so there's a lot of work that is being done, that including setting industrial parks, including seeing what are the challenges that those sectors have faced, how can we also bring investors, how can we train, how can we use technology. So believe you me, in the next 3-5 years, I think you'll see a lot of change in those two sectors. So there's a lot of hope in that. But also we do have Innovation Kenya. That's a new association that we have formed under KEPSA, so that to help startups and also these sectors that have not had a place to go in the past. And there are a lot of investors who want to be in those sectors, but they've not known how to be. So if you do like to join that association, it's pretty young, so we'd really be happy for more people to come in and give it the strength that it needs to grow, so that we can really be use it. So it's called Innovate Kenya, but really it's all about people who I think have great ideas, want to start business, who are starting business, who are small SMEs, who've been there for a year, 2 years, 3 years, the life cycle of an SME, as we had called it. In terms of how policy and the whole election cycle in Kenya, one, I'd say there's what is affected, but there's what remains. And the good thing that has happened in the last maybe several years, because of having a vision for the country, Vision 2030, that has kept whichever administration comes to power aligned to a vision of a country. So the policies do not change that much. And if you notice, if you look at what was there the last 5 years and that is being implemented now, is very similar. Nothing has changed much. So a few things may be introduced, especially in areas where a new administration will feel that they need to bring in strength, but a lot doesn't change in the big area of policy. So we're still implementing Vision 2030. It's divided in 5 medium-term plans. So those plans are measured, and because government doesn't really change, an administration changes, but government remains. And so that really has helped in that. Second time SMEs, do we have data? We have not collected data, but I think this is lessons we've learned from many countries. And so as we focus a lot more on SMEs, I think we'll start putting data together. But from what we've learned from other countries, a lot of second time SMEs do last and do survive longer, because there are a lot of lessons learned the first time round. And then because of what we are putting, and especially associations like Innovation Kenya, this will really help, so that those who are second timers are still able to be in a place where they can grow. Then the Insolvency Act. Remember when companies folded, there was nothing to govern them. And now with the new Insolvency Act, that should help them fold properly and then be able to start all over again. So that should help in that. Definition of SMEs, I think SMEs are defined in many ways. And the way we find that Kenya seems to divide them into different parts. We have MSCs and we have SMEs. And MSCs here are the micro. And then the SMEs are more the small and medium. But as I said, what we call here small in other countries are what is micro. And what we call here medium in other countries is what is small. But we realize that we have to really contextualize our own environment. So we are not there where we have a multinational that is 3 times Kenya's GDP. You know, we don't have any of our big companies that is the size of, even half the size of the GDP of the country. So we've had to have our own definitions that fit our country. And so that's how we group them. So we have SMEs, MSCs, and SMEs. And in our work, we know when we bring the street vendor and a mamamboga, we know those are actually the micro people. And then we bring people who have maybe employ 3 to about 7 people. Those ones we call them more of SMEs because they have at least survived more than 5 years. They're starting to employ. They're just not a one-man show. So we've grouped them in a different way, and I can offer them a lot more on that information. On SMEs and public-private dialogue and how to take that information down, this is where the power of association comes in. And that's why we insist that if you're a business, belong to an association. You know, if you're in the tea industry and there's a tea association, belong to that tea association. The tea association will then be a member of KEPSA. But at the same time, it doesn't stop you to be a member of tea association and a member of KEPSA. You still get the information, but also we encourage our association, when we get this information, especially from the apex bodies, disseminate to your members. So you who are members of associations and are not getting information, push your associations to get that information to you, because we've realized there are some associations where we send the information to the CEO and the CEO consumes but doesn't send to the members. You know, so we really would like to see a lot of that information get back to the members. And when we say we have a reach of more than 100,000 companies, it's because we expect our members to disseminate that information to their members so that they are getting the same information from us. You know, so you can be both a member of your primary association and of the apex body, but at the same time, if you don't have the capacity or the time, you can be a member of your association, but push your association to give you the information that is coming from us. SME and tax, a very good question. And again, there's hope coming and a good something that is already being done. I don't know about the other countries in the region, but in Kenya now there's a specific SME tax. And so you can apply that for KRA. So you're not taxed at the same level as a big corporate. So that is information also SMEs need to have. And so when we have forums with KRA, we encourage the SMEs to be in those forums so that you understand what is expected of you and not look at KRA as a policeman, but actually that it's a joy to contribute your tax because this is what it does for you. And you also be able to make the demands from KRA. Thank you very much.
Wow. Thank you very much, Carol. You've taken them head on. The next batch of questions, and then one, two. Please.
Yes, my name is Francis. My question goes to me, Carol. Yes, I wanted just to know, to be a member of KEPSA, what are the criteria?
You didn't tell us who you are and from where?
I'm Francis from Helen Foundation.
Thank you, Francis. There's a hand next to you. Ah, okay.
My question wasn't
answered. Wow.
Yeah.
Which one was it?
Please repeat it again.
Well, my question was, how do you facilitate growth of me if I come to you as an SME, and how do you foster markets? Because I saw you did a really good presentation, but I was wondering, as an individual SME, how would you help me?
Okay, thank you. That's the second one now, second round. And here, sir, behind the screen.
My name is Jeremy Olo from Consumer Pride Africa. I was just seeking a clarification when it comes to defining SME. We understand the way you'd want to define SME in Kenya would be different the way you want to define it in Germany. So what is this criteria that defines an SME? Is it the number of people or the revenue you're generating as a business? Thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Are you having a question, sir? No. Okay. We have three, and it seems they're all resting with Caro again.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me start with the question that I had not answered. How do we facilitate growth for SMEs and the issue of markets? One, information. Because what we realize, and I think that was pointed out by one of the speakers earlier, that what SMEs lack is information. So we do offer information. And also we give you opportunities to access information. That's why I was saying, when we have forums like with KRA and others, you want to be present because that's where information is. Secondly, there are a lot of organizations that we partner with that offer training for SMEs. You find, as someone said, you have a good business plan, but you don't know what to do with it. So you find training on what can I do with a business plan and what is a real good business plan, because you may think it's a good business plan. Or how do I access credit as an SME? We also partner with government institutions that are focused on SMEs, you know, where they are offering SME fund and all that. So we're able to get you in touch with these, some of these funds, so that you interact with them and be able to access. Because we do have, I've met enough, even the ones who want to access youth fund or women fund and say, I don't even know where to go. And so we realize, even though that information is in the website of these organizations, or it's even being announced in media, I don't know what happens. People don't get it. And so they want an individual. So sometimes what we do, we get links to the specific individual so that we're able to tell you, go to this office. This is the person who deals with this. You know, so that a lot of it, we realize it's information and then networks. You want to network with others who are doing the same thing as you are, or others who've been there before you, or even the big companies. One of the things that we are really, really pushing a lot of the big entrepreneurs, the Chris Grubys, the Vimal Shahs, to do is mentor the SMEs, because they are SMEs themselves at one point. So there's a lot they learned along the way that they can share. And so when you're part of us, these are the forums you meet these people. And so you get to learn, you get to hear, and you're able to follow through, and they mentor you through these processes. So this is what is important for being part of that. The other one, I was on KEPSA membership, it's very easy. There's just a form you need to fill. We get to know your details, and we give you the categories. If you want to join one of the associations, we have the whole list of the associations. We can introduce you to one of the associations. If you just want to join the Apex body directly, the same thing. So if you go to our website, www.kepsa.or.ke, all the information is there. There's also contact details that you can get. And I think there's someone sitting right next to you who is a KEPSA officer who can even give you a lot more details on what you need to do. Actually, two of them. SME, I think in Kenya we do revenue numbers. It keeps being revised. Sorry, I've been talking since morning. It keeps being revised, so I don't have the numbers quickly, but I think we can put it up again on our website, the current ones. I'm being told it's there. So please visit the website. You'll get to know how the definitions we use, because you'll find World Bank defines it a different way. But what we do, we collect all this and see what is similar, and then we use that as our definition for SMEs in Kenya.
Thank you very much, Carol. I think our time is running out. And just a brief summation. Nobody's an island, or no organization is an island. You need to work together to be able to achieve your results. The PPP approach works. It needs to be nurtured. It needs to be appreciated. It needs to be driven by all that is the private sector, the government arm. SMEs can get competitive and be able to contribute to their national and global economy. And finally, I think it is possible for the SMEs to create a difference in the global economy if they are given the tools and the platforms that they desire. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the presenters and the panelists. Usually 1.5 hour presentation like this takes a whole month or 2 months to put together and agree on approaches and everything else. They've done quite a bit of work at the background. And thank you very much, George, Patrick, Christoph, Carol, and Sam, and of course myself. It was a pleasure having you in our midst. A lot of the queries which are not brought out verbally, please visit the website of the respective organizations and you'll be able to get more. I believe we shall meet in the next WTO. It should be in Kenya again. And we look forward to meeting again. God bless.